welcome everyone. I am Vaidishwaran, your host today, and I'm from Chennai, and it's wonderful to have all of you over here. And this is actually for my YouTube channel called the Empathic Designer Podcast, and I've just put a link to my channel on the chat window for all of you to look at. I've been in the L&D industry for over 12 years now, and today's podcast recording that we're doing right now is actually in the wake of the COVID-19 situation, where we are finding a lot of trainers who are moving into the virtual space now. And as we are moving into the virtual space, the slide decks that we create, the designs that we do, seems to take more space compared to what we used to have in a typical classroom. So I have been receiving a lot of questions on how to go about this design, how to create a strategy when it comes to designing programs, designing these slide decks, particularly for virtual training sessions. And that's why I thought, rather than me addressing it, I have an expert over here, Mr. Jyotinath Balaji, who can absolutely talk to this. And he's an expert, as you all know. And so we're going to be spending the next hour and a half talking about how to go about with improving our presentation skills, and what are some of the important things that we need to remember from a trainer's perspective when it comes to designing the slide deck. So let me give a brief introduction to Jyotinath ji. I mean, most of you know him, but still it is absolutely my duty to introduce him to all of you. So Jyotinath Balaji is the chairman and managing director of Chennai's leading advertising firm AdInfix, and he's been doing business since 1983. He's a self-seasoned professional who has worked closely with top executives in leading corporates in various verticals like engineering, automotive services, IT, and IT-enabled services. And he has also worked on creating some powerful advertising strategies, tactical thinking across a diverse range of advertising services, providing end-to-end solutions in print, electronic, and digital media. That's really what we're talking about today. And his contributions has really enabled a great deal of augmentation of growth in the organization by adding blue chip companies like CSS Core, HCL Technologies, Ford, FL Schmidt, Renault, Nissan, Petrofac, Murugappa Group, Sutherland Global Services, the World Bank, and so many other companies. And his specialties, since he hails from the ad industry, includes ATL and BTL activities. He's involved in creating strategic solutions for print, audiovisual, and digital media. And one of his strong points is his expertise in innovation thinking and digital business transformation. So he gives a lot of advice to a lot of organizations in that area. And he's a C-suite strategist, a certified corporate leader. So he's associated with IATD, which is one of the most premier institutes when it comes to training and development. And he's also a certified NLP practitioner. And from an ad perspective, he is a Google certified AdWords specialist. He's Google certified in digital insights. And he has been a digital advisor for a lot of firms. So with that introduction, I would like to start today's episode with Jyotinath Balaji, sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome to the session. So like I was saying, in the wake of the COVID-19 situation, we are having a lot of challenges when it comes to developing a lot of these learning first, the learning programs itself, adapting them to the virtual world. And if you go through my channel, I would have produced some episodes on some of the strategies that you can use when it comes to creating L&D programs for virtual instructor-led training. And today's session is specifically focused on this aspect of creating presentations and working on your presentation skills for the virtual environment. So without further ado, let me get started. So Jyotinath Balaji, sir, the first question for you. See, this year 2020 seems like a watershed year for the training industry, where we are witnessing a surge in the shift from classroom training to the virtual world. We are having so many Zoom meetings, and I'm sure all of us can relate to that. The number of Zoom meetings that we are attending each day is going up so much. And with this slide deck vying for space compared to what we used to have from a trainer perspective. So do you see a shift in the impact of these presentations from a design perspective? So I'd like you to introduce this topic for all of us.
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much. I'm hoping all of you are able to hear me. I think I put myself also on mute. I put it on mute also. I got muted. I'm sure all of you are able to hear me. I guess, YDG, you are able to hear me because everybody else is muted.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah, thank you so much. And I would request also you also to increase your volume slightly. Few of them have sent a chat saying that you can slightly increase your volume.
I hope this is better.
Yeah, much better. Yeah.
Okay.
So coming to the question, now definitely there is a slight change when it comes to PPTs or whether it is delivery or whether it is the way we interact with our learners. Definitely there is a shift. So I'm going to share some of the differences between a classroom training versus online training, because I have also been conducting classroom sessions as well as webinar sessions. I know definitely webinars are going to be a little more tougher. I'm repeating, it's not easy. It is a little more tougher when it comes to classroom training, because in classroom training, your behavior, your approach, all these things get you the reputation, respect, and you're able to immediately connect with people. Whereas in the online space, that is very difficult. In a Zoom meeting, normally we don't have too much time to socialize. So the biggest problem would be, how do you reduce, because there is not much of socializing element, how are you able to connect with the participants or the learners? So I'll just quickly shift to my PPT, because if you look at it, based on the questions we have received yesterday and today, we had quickly prepared a PPT to share it with you, because the idea is a PowerPoint presentation, and if I don't have a PPT, that may not really look good.
Absolutely.
So
friends, we are getting a demo today.
Yes.
Fantastic. That's a bonus. Great.
I tried my level best. Let's see how it works. Because I have been juggling between a lot of webinars in the last last 2 months. So I'm going to quickly share my PPT file.
Sure.
Okay, so let me share the screen. So I'm hoping all of you are able to see my PPT. You can just type POP if you're able to see it in the screen. So just type POP if you're able to see it in the screen. I'll quickly look at the chat windows. So because I want all of you to interact along with me, let us assume that it is a classroom training. So if it was a classroom training, let's see how we can do that together. Yeah, thank you so much. Many of you have responded. Thanks, Usha ji, Kamini ji, Mohini ji, and Monisha ji, I'm sorry. And who else? A lot of people have replied. Ira ji, thank you so much. Okay, thanks for connecting. I request Srivani madam to please help Nag sir, because he is trying to reach me. I can't take the call right now. So if you can, you can just speak to him and tell how he got connected. I mean, you came into
Jyoti sir. Jyoti sir, can I interrupt you in between for a second?
Yeah, please go ahead. May I know who's this?
Neha this side. Actually, Amita Malhotra, she's also trying to get inside.
I'm not okay.
From Delhi
okay.
Batch.
Yeah, okay. Let me, I think I've missed lot of people who are coming in.
Okay, I'm admitting them, Jyoti sir. You can please continue.
Go ahead. Yeah, that will be of great help. Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so today's topic is power of presentation. So I'll see how best I can share the power of presentation in the virtual training space. The second important thing is the shift we are undergoing, because it's a disruptive learning. Now, online courses are there, but what generally used to happen is corporate training normally happens in a classroom setup. And today, if you look at it, there are a lot of companies who are approaching, even for corporate training, they wanted to do in a webinar format. So definitely there is a shift in terms of learning, and this I say is disruptive learning. If you look at the traditional online courses, it was more to do with a course which needed a certification and something like that, or it could be a higher education or skill development. Okay, but today it is more to do with everything and anything and everything is today converted from a classroom training to a online training. Now there are two big challenges when it comes to online training. I mentioned sometime back, one is the ability to earn trust and respect within a very short span of time. That is the first big challenge. The second challenge is persuasion needs to be bigger, because normal persuasion, what we do, may not be really sufficient enough for our regular, for our online sessions. So I just wanted to, can all of you type 2C if you are able to get the point? If you have any doubt, please type it in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself and raise a doubt. So I request all of you to mute yourself. Whenever you want to raise a doubt, please unmute yourself and you can raise a doubt. Okay, and you will also have a hand symbol. Okay, you will also have a hand symbol in case you want to raise a doubt. Please click on the hand symbol so that I will get to know that you are raising your hand and I can answer your doubt. Okay. So these are the two big challenges. Now let us see what is the fundamental difference between a classroom training versus an online training. So I'm going to just run a few of the things. The first one is we miss the social interaction. Now, if you see the kind of bonding we all have in classroom sessions, during the tea breaks is where the maximum bonding happens. Do you all agree with me? Just say yes if you, alphabet yes. If you feel that it resonates with you. Yeah, so most of us have our bonding during the tea breaks more than the sessions which are happening live. It is the social bonding we have in the tea breaks and after the class which is actually keeping us more connected. Now what happened is the social interaction is lost. Now one of the things which we should do is we should definitely have small breaks in between. Ask people to randomly talk, or you also have breakthrough sessions, which means that you can create break rooms within Zoom or during your presentation in Zoom, where you can group people separately, like how we used to have group activities. You can also have group activities separately and you can interact with people. So this is one of the way you can bring in social interaction. And the second thing is you need to add a lot of personal stories in your Zoom sessions. Otherwise, there will not be much connection with our audience. Okay, so this is the first thing. The second one is instruction methodology. Now, in the class, what happens is we can stretch the topic a little bit. We can wait for people to respond. We can try to, stretch time. We can try to keep a standard pace, or we can try to, make our tone a little more gentle. Whereas in the online space, you need to be very, very, very focused about the pace of learning. You need to constantly understand if all of you have got the point. Whereas in a classroom training, it need not be a must. But when it comes to, online sessions, we need to keep constantly understanding whether people are keeping pace. So that is where you can use your chat box more efficiently to ensure that everything, anything and everything you speak about, you can also. Deepak G says picture clear but audio is not. Am I audible to everyone?
You are audible to me.
Yeah. Okay, audible, I think that sir, is an audible. Individual problem with the internet. So yes, I am audible to everyone. Okay, so now, since we are talking about audio, tone, clarity, and to the point, so I wanted to check once again. And we have to be to the point. We cannot really stretch things. So this is the second challenge we will have in a Zoom session. The third challenge we would have is we need to use a lot of audio and visual stories. We need to ensure we use the right kind of font. I'm hoping all of you are able to see the right kind of font in the screen. So I'm just trying to zoom in a little bit. Give me a little time. Are you able to see the full screen of what I'm showing, or are you able to see 1/4? Are you able to see the full screen?
Okay, we are actually seeing your speaker view.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So let me just change it to the full view.
Yeah.
Just a second, let me change it to the full view. I don't know why this is happening. Okay, give me a second. It's coming by default. Okay. I think there is some problem in terms of switching of screen.
Okay, I think we could probably continue this way because at least I can see what's there on your screen.
Yeah, because I wanted the font to be very clear.
Okay.
So that's the idea.
Sir, you can move into the presentation mode actually.
I'm already there, but I don't know why it is not coming up.
Okay.
I think I shouldn't have switched it. Okay. Resume
slide. This is better than the earlier one. This is better than the earlier one.
Yeah, this is better. Yeah. You can see at least 80% of it.
Okay, yes. So let me try to zoom it a little more. I wanted to show it in the full screen, but then it is not coming up. It's okay. Let us not waste too much time.
Yeah, this is
try F11.
Yeah. The fourth one is we need to definitely be very learner focused. Just a second, few more people are asking to be admitted, sir.
Yeah. So I am admitting everyone, sir. Please, you can continue.
Yeah. So the fourth point is when it comes to learning on online session, there will be a lot of skepticism and rationale. You need to be giving each and every slide before we run into it. We need to give a lot of rationale as to why they should do. What is the objective behind sharing the slide? All these things have to be definitely put in a very, very proper form. And there will be a lot of skepticism because we are not seeing face to face the doubts. And second thing, if you look at it in a classroom setup, there will be one or two people sitting next to us. So who can definitely clarify if there is a doubt by a co-learner. Whereas in an online space, that will not be possible. It becomes even more important for a trainer to ensure that you give a proper rationale as to why you are showing the slide, what is the importance of this, or it has to be very, very, very clearly mentioned. Only then a learner will be able to get idea. The fifth is level of personalization, polls, interactive chat, instant relevance, feedbacks, and takeaways are very important. So after every slide, maybe you should ask people to chat in the give a chat in the chat box saying what they could take away from this. And the sixth point is the e-learning time. If you look at the e-learning, it is basically 40% lesser than your classroom training. So if you are planning something in the online space, if you are planning for something for 1 hour, you need to plan it for 1.5 hours or maybe 1 hour 20 minutes. That is how e-learning as a platform works. So you need to have a little more content than the time you are expected to run the PPT. But at the same time, if you are having more interaction, yes, it is fine, but always have a little more stuff so that in case something is going fast, you can try to use more content. Now, I want all of you to quickly type in the chat box if there is anything you would like to know in this particular slide. So this is basically the difference between online training versus a classroom training. There are six basic differences. First one is the social interaction, which is where we won't have any emotional connect. So trainers have to be sharing more story, make it more interactive, and make it more lively. So that is one challenge which we would face. The second thing is instruction methodology. We need to use a particular tone, clarity of font, and you have to be to the point. Third one, of course, is we are very familiar. We need to use a lot of audio visuals material. I'm also going to share some tools on how you can get audio visual animation and all that in a short span of time. The fourth one is learner focused. Definitely, you need to be not normally what happens is as trainers, we are so inclined to give whatever we have and fail to at times understand what is the learner's perspective. We cannot take the chances here. We need to ensure that we are in the learner's mindset. The fifth one is level of personalization. So you need to ensure that you interact with all the participants through chats, or there are polls which are available. So you can actually use the poll option which is available in Zoom and use it. The sixth one is e-learning. So e-learning time is basically, Trivani madam has asked, I'm not very clear on the sixth point. So e-learning is, you need to plan 40% more content. Sometimes what happens is, if you plan for 1 hour, sometimes it may go faster than as you expect in a classroom session. So you need to have 40% more content. So what I mean to say is 1 minute classroom is not equal to 1 minute online. It is 40 seconds. So that's how it is in the online space. Yeah, I think we are basically, before we get into what has to be done, I wanted to give an outline as what are the challenges. Now let us get into the next aspect. Vaidhi sir, you can go ahead with your... Yes, go ahead please.
Absolutely. Thanks a lot for that. So my next question is to you is actually, what in your opinion really makes a good presentation?
Okay. So I have also done a lot of mess-ups in the past, trying to, give the same classroom training in the webinar and trying to, I think there are three basic types of presentations which we need to understand first. When it comes to training, I think there are three major things we need to look at. Okay, so give me a second. I will get disconnected in the next 10 minutes. I will again join the group after 10 minutes. Not now, I will continue. But in case I get disconnected, please be assured that I will rejoin and continue. So I'm just keeping you posted. I'm keeping all the members posted so that in case there is a disconnection, I will rejoin once again in 10 minutes.
Sure.
Yeah. So there are three basic, things when it comes to training. I've also done a lot of mess up. The first one is it's a presentation based training. It can be some basic information, some compliance training, workplace ethics, posh, safety. So the idea is, it is you are just sharing the information in form of a PPT. So it is just for people to learn certain basics, for example, soft skill training. You're not really creating a big change, but you are trying to tell trying to tell about dining etiquette. Okay, so that is something which people will just see and learn. Okay, there is no need of going in depth. So basically, your PPT can just have certain images, and we will also see how to choose images in a little while. But then the idea is to learn faster. If you look at it, presentation type training, the objective is to learn faster, and the idea is to just share information, infographic. It can also be anything related to compliance training, workshop ethics, CISA kind of stuff. The second one is driven, performance driven. So normally, I'm sure anybody in the L&D department would know or would have heard a lot about KPI and KRA. Okay, so KPI is key performance indicator, where after every training, they are expected to show some result in terms of cutting down of time or in terms of, trying to show an improvement. So the second one is performance support training, where people have to retain a lot more knowledge. We need to show as trainers on how to simplify a task, how to use demo videos and post questions and help solve a lot of problems. So I was initially doing some, workshop for Delphi TVS. It's a CNC machining company. They were actually hiring people. Their HR team was actually downsized, and they wanted me to do a part of regular training, induction kind of a thing, where, I will be sharing some basic things and then they will come over and the HR will talk about the codes, policies and stuff like that. So I was thinking, this is too monotonous. Why should every time I go and give it? And then I created a video for them on how to, switch on the machine, switch off the machine, what they should do. It was a comprehensive video where people the new inductees will get to know on how to switch out the machine, where to check for certain quality things, and all these things were created as form of video and given. So we also need to, if you are looking at performance support training, you need to have a lot of videos. It may not, the regular kind of training may not really work for performance support. Now the third level is a skill-based training. Now if you look at digital marketing, basically it comes under this kind of thing where people at the end of the workshop should be able to do something on their own. They need to know how they can improvise the tasks. They need to know how they can do themselves or do everything by their own. So the reason I'm sharing that is before we start getting into doing our slides, what category is our presentation falling into? Okay, that is something which we really need to think of, because we jump into, starting to create slides, look for pictures and all that. But ideally, we need to understand what category our training is and then start building on our slide deck. So Vaidhiji, you can, I'm requesting all of you to just type 3T. If you're able to get these three types of training, just type 3T, which means that I assume that you have understood what is the basic three differences between training. I'm hoping it is useful. In case you have any doubt, please raise your hand, or you can please unmute yourself and ask a doubt.
Yeah.
So this is not, you can say it's a part of training need analysis, but before you create your slide, you have to see whether you are in a basic level of training, or do you want people to learn faster? Do you want them to retain more? Or do you want them to apply better? Okay. Chirag Dhawan, I quickly repeat it. So the first objective is you will only choose presentation based on images or certain messages you want to convey. There is no big transformation people have to undergo because of this training. Of course, there will be certain trainings like dining etiquettes or something to do with, something a trainer tells and the learners watch. They just have to take the information inside and remember that. That's all. The second one is a process-oriented training where people have to demonstrate some changes after the training. The third one is people need to know by themselves on how to do certain things. Okay, I'm hoping that you have got it. Dr. Supriya has said, can you give an example? Okay, so if you look at an example for each. Now, I'll quickly tell once again, if you're a soft skill trainer, okay, and just want to show the importance of spoken English, okay, so you just tell the importance of spoken English and how it really matters. It can be stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 also. The first level is to show the importance of knowing English. The second one is you are rigging them to actually go through certain dictionary or do something which is very practical for them, where they have to start improvising. The third one is a skill-based training, which means that you are going to give them daily exercises, ensure that they learn something on a daily basis and they come back. So if I have to give a simple example, if I'm going to just show about what is digital marketing, okay, then I put a PPT slide saying there is social media marketing, there is Facebook, Instagram and all that. That's all. There is no knowledge transfer which is actually happening. People only know that these are the benefits. Whereas in a performance-based training, I need to go a little more in-depth and tell these are the features on how you can operate. The third one is a skill-based training where you need to make people actually do it. Now, let us take Train the Trainer itself for an example. There are certain portions of, the Train the Trainer program where only PPTs will do. There are certain portions where you have to form groups, try to retain the knowledge. You are given an activity. You are supposed to do that activity and come back and share it in the stage. So what's happening now? Basically, you are trying to implement the learning you have undergone. The third one is you create your 45 minute presentation where you are molded to a level where you create and speak on your for your 45 minutes. I'm hoping it is clear. Any doubts? Any doubts? You can just type in the chat box. Otherwise, I will go on. I will ask Vaidhi sir to go to the next doubt.
Sure. Thanks a lot for that comprehensive explanation, sir.
I'm hoping all of you are able to see my screen now.
Yes, we can.
Okay, fantastic. So the structure and story, which is very important. Now, very often I see that in corporates, now what happens is they start off with something. They really don't, it is called top-down messaging. You can Google it a little later. So top-down messaging is nothing but you are trying to share the procedures, the processes without actually giving what is the end game. What is the end benefit? Now, normally what happens is in classroom, if somebody is not clear about it, so they will ask randomly. But then when in a Zoom meeting, we normally tend to mute everyone or we try to, you know, the trainer takes the lead. So we others are not allowed much to speak. So in that case, the most important thing is, if you remember a couple of minutes back, I shared that there needs to be a clear structure before you start your slide. So the first thing is moving from top-down messaging to bottom-up messaging, which means that what is the end result you are going to get out of seeing this slide or out of this presentation. So this is something which we need to clearly define, saying for each slide, we need to tell how is this going to benefit at the end of the presentation or at the if you are trying to give all this information upfront. So you are basically giving the end game in advance itself, telling that these are the takeaways for this slide. So the bottoms up messaging is very important. So you need to share the end result or end benefit of putting the slide. So that is the most important thing. Second one is, so the first, yes, denotes to structure and story. I'm also going to share in a few more minutes on what are the how to create a story guideline. So that is also something I'll be sharing shortly. The second one is understand the learner's mindset and have less text. So normally if you look at the text, you look at the slides, I've seen many people use a lot of text that has to be totally avoided. Now instead, we need to resonate with our audience mind and understand how to create for emotional response. So it is basically I would like to, you know, talk about empath here, because Vaidhi's channel is empathic.
Empathic Designer Podcast. Yes,
yeah,
sir.
Empathic Designer Podcast. Empath. We need to be empaths, not trainers, basically. So when I say empath, you are giving information plus emotion, which leads to empath, which is nothing but you are trying to be in an emotional, you are able to bring in emotion into your information. So that is what is empath. We have to be empaths. So we need to design for our entire slide based on emotional aspects. So I'm sure many of you would have seen certain basic things like joy, surprise, and all that. But there are a few more, you know, psychology of emotion says there is something called as Aumbak, which means that a fear of loneliness. There is something called as a fear of, you can just Google it later on. So it's basically the emotions, or I can share it a little later on in the chat box. So there are some three or four types of emotions. One is about emptiness. The second one is about trying to be destructive. So if you look at some of the ads, Onida and all that, they try to bang the TV and say it is neighbor's envy, owner's pride. So these are the deeper emotions within us. Sometimes we try to dig out on those emotions as well. And have you seen Onida ads where, you know, the TV is broken and then it says neighbor's envy, owner's pride. So you can use emotion, not just about joy, happiness or sorrow or whatever it is. It can go beyond that, where it can be about destruction, if you want to connect with those people, I mean with your learners, if you want to show that it could be destructive, if you don't do this, or this is what happens. This is the destruction that will happen if you don't follow the process. You can try to use a little more emotions. There is something called as fear of time running out. Have you seen the, you know, clock melting and all this stuff? So these are kind of different kind of emotions which you can try to show in a slide. So don't go by the regular kind of slide where you just put up a, you know, smiling face. If I have to put it in a simpler form, being in advertising, sometimes I laugh at ads which I see in the newspapers. I've seen one ad of a leading gym where, you know, the guy is trying to lift, weightlift. Okay, the guy is trying to weightlift, 100. Now, if you are going to a gym and if you're trying to lift 100 kg of weight, would you be spying? Can you just type it in the chat box? Would we be smiling or not? Smile, yes or N. You can just type yes or N.
Absolutely not.
Absolutely not.
I won't be.
But what happens generally is when we try to use images, we don't pay much attention to that. And then we try to put a smiling guy lifting a weight. Instead, that should be a guy who's really finding hard to lift. That is where it, you know, resonates with people. So we need to ensure when we are talking about emotions, we bring in the right kind of picture. So right. This is one example. I'm hoping that all of you are getting the point. The objective is, think if you are doing that, how would you feel? Or from the audience point of view, if he is a youngster, now the messaging may be slightly different. If he is a, you know, 40-year-old guy, the messaging may be slightly different. So you need to understand your audience mindset and then start choosing your kind of language or image or whatever it is. The third one is I, which is imagination and images. Now, if you look at TEDx, I'm sure all of you would have seen the image they are putting up and the speech they are giving may not be really relevant. Okay, but what are they, how are they trying to bring out certain images? Okay, and because they are the specialists in it, now let us understand how TEDx people are trying to put up their images. If you look at it, they try to look for concepts. For example, if somebody is talking about creativity, now gone are the days where people talk, use the same box, open somebody inside the box and all that. Instead, you can try and see if you are if you are able to bring out a splash of colors. Okay, so this is something which we can try to imagine and see what really resonates with the concept. If you want to search something, you can say personality concepts, or you can say spiritual concepts. You'll be able to see a lot of images which are actually matching along with the concepts. So I'm hoping all of you are getting it. Is it too technical? You can just type T if you're finding it technical. If you're finding it simple, type yes. So simple denotes yes, T denotes technical. So if it is technical, I will try to simplify it a little more. Okay, majority of the people have told yes. So I will leave it as it is. So you can also look for metaphors, and you can also look at sometimes putting it literal. So you can decide on how you want to choose your images, but please ensure you either look for concepts, or you look for metaphor, or you look for literal, something literal. So can someone give an example of a metaphor? I just wanted to make it more interactive. So if you had something to put as a metaphor, okay, what do you think can we put? Or it can be a concept also. Can I have someone to unmute themselves and share their view of what could be a metaphor or what could be a concept? Anybody who would like to share?
Okay, so we... Okay, so we have some metaphors coming up. So one is Jyotinath is a shining star, wonderful. And we have one more, raining like cats and dogs, like a butterfly fluttering, green with envy.
Fantastic.
We're having some fantastic inputs coming here in the chat.
Wow, awesome. Thank you, Suresh sir. Thank you, Garden Ambience, Rajiv sir. Thank you, Sukanya ji, and thank you Durga Prasad sir, thank you so much. Now how would I put it? Now if I had to put myself in Jyotinath as a shining star, I'm going to give you a quick example of how I can put myself. I'm going to put my picture inside a shape of a star. So do you think this makes sense? Okay, now if I have to mention this image of Jyotinath as a shining star, if I have to convert or translate that text into an image, I can put my profile picture in a star shape. Now the next one is cats and dogs, raining cats and dogs, or a little butterfly fluttering. So you can actually put a butterfly, and you can also move the wind faster. Okay, so it is like having two backgrounds. One is a blurred background and the other one of butterfly is a very, very clear background. So this is how we can illustrate our image. Then we also have few more green with envy. Now I can put my picture like this. Okay, are all of you able to see my picture? Somewhere it should be visible. I am doing like this. And I put a green overlay on top of my image. Okay, I am going to put a green color on top of my image. So this tries to show that I'm in an emotion of green. So if you look at orange, there is a brighter side. Red is something to do with the prosperity. So there are a lot of color psychologies. You can actually look at the color psychologies also and have one small tint of green or red or orange behind your image. That is also going to make it a lot more convincing when you put up your slide. Why is this required? Because you will not have much time to build that emotional connect. Your slide should do the talking. Because if you are standing in front of the audience, if you remember our Train the Trainer days, okay, the presentation is secondary. Rajan sir would have told, presentation is secondary. The person who is standing in first front becomes the primary. But where are we here in the screen? Somewhere in the corner. We really don't know where we are also. I am searching for my short screen and I'm not able to find myself. So here the hero is the slide and not the trainer. So which is why it is more important. The fourth one is direct attention. I'm sure many of you who attended my IITD sessions would remember the focal point. Can anybody share the example I quote for focal point? I have given a very good illustration for focal point. Can anyone quickly share the illustration I had given for a focal point? Anyone? Can you type it in the chat box or you can unmute yourself and try to share it, whichever you feel is comfortable. Wheelchair, yes. Golden circle. Okay. Should I share it? It's a lipstick.
Yeah.
It's a lipstick. Okay. So a lady looking at the clock versus a lady looking at the camera directly. So the difference is, now I don't want to switch my slide and go into it. But then if you recollect, it's you have a clock, a lady having a clock, and it's about time management. Now this lady looks at the camera and says, ah. Okay, so that is the one I had actually put up. The other one is the lady looks at the clock and says like this. So the idea is, where do you want people to focus in the slide? Please be clear about it. Depth of field is something you need to make certain things sharp, certain things slightly blurred and all that. You can denote it using arrows. Please ensure that you're using arrows like this to denote the point. Use certain masked areas. For example, you may want to use some circle or whatever it is. Try to remove all the unwanted areas. So these are some tips which you can look at, you know, create direct attention. And the fifth one is, of course, maintain the typo across. So if you look at this entire slide of mine, I have tried to use certain style of fonts in the same style of color, the gradient. This is called the gradient. So basically, I've tried to use indigo and blue color. So I'm trying to use these kind of colors across so that there is a uniformity in whatever I'm trying to do. So basically, this is called consistency of style. So I try to retain the same flavor and style across the slides. So Anybody has a doubt so far? If you have a doubt, please type it in the chat box. If you have a doubt, otherwise I would request Vaidhi sir to proceed with the next question.
Absolutely. That was a fantastic explanation that you gave with that slide. And what I basically understood from what you're saying is that a good slide basically tells us a good story.
Absolutely.
So can you tell us what makes a good story?
Yes. Before we get into storytelling, we first have to understand for trainers, there are four types of stories. I'm not sure how many of you know that. Anybody can anybody tell what kind of stories can we actually use? The fifth point, okay, Deepa ji is asking the fifth point before we go into the next question. It is all about using arrows. I think I've explained it. I can take it after the meeting, Deepa ji. I'll go into the next slide. I will attend to it after the session is over, okay? So the direct, there are four types of story. I'm going to slightly minimize the screen. Actually, it was supposed to come one after the other. I'm breaking the suspense now. So the first type of story is, it could be a memorable incident. I was given a task in Flipkart where I was asked, what inspires you to make a blog? Because blogging and story writing is almost the same. And I was giving a lot of examples on how they have to blog and all that. Now, definitely there will be witty audiences, especially in these IT companies, okay? They are always, trying to outsmart the trainer. So one of them asked me, if I had to create a blog for, the standard operating procedures of the company or the core values of the company, how can I do that using a blog? Is it interesting? If you have to share core values of a company, now what have you seen core values along with our appointment order? Have you seen along with our appointment order core values? Yes, those are a series of points which code of conduct or core values. So these were some of the things which that guy was asking me. The participant was asking me, how do I put the core values or code of conduct in terms of a blog? So this was a little shocking at that point of time because I thought I was also cornered. But thankfully, I said, give me a few minutes. I'll think about it and get back. And fortunately, I had a tea break. I said, give me a few minutes. I will think about it and get back and answer the question after the tea break. So while everybody were sipping their tea, I was totally confused on how I'm going to tackle this question. So luckily, before going into Flipkart, I was going through a lot of videos about the founders. Who are the Bhatias, if I'm right? Can anyone share who are the founders of I'm sorry, I'm not able to quickly recollect the name. So,
Bansal.
Who are the founders of Flipkart? I'm not sure.
Bansal.
Bansal, yeah, sorry. It's Bansal, yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
South Indians always have a difficulty in remembering North Indian names. So, I think that's one of the difficulty I had here. So, I misplaced, heroine's name, I forgot. Anyway, let's not get into that. Tamanna Bhatia. I think Tamanna Bhatia got into my head instead of Bansal's. Okay. So the first thing is I actually went through a lot of videos which are related to the Bansal's. And in one of the situations he was sharing before he acquired Myntra. So the Myntra CEO had come for a meeting to understand how Flipkart is actually trying to promote their services in the online space. So the Myntra CEO had come down to Flipkart office, and he was talking to a retailer, a seller, and he was trying to understand something on the most popular product which was going on. So he said, please give me a minute, I'm going to come back to the Myntra CEO and said he continued speaking with his retailer. So I said one of the code of the conducts can be related to something like this, where you say that the customer is the most important person. Okay, even though it's a business meeting, customer is the most important thing. So that is where I could somehow relate what Bansal was doing in his period or in his life and relate it with the code of conduct. So these are maybe one or two ways where you have to try and see what are all the stories which are available around us and how you can make them as memorable incidents. So thankfully after that the witty, you know, learner didn't ask anything more than that. I'm hoping this is a little convincing, because if you have to create, if you have to just share something related to code of conduct or ethics, now there may be a situation where you will have to illustrate with a story. It need not be ours. It can be somebody else's story where you want to narrate so that it matches along with the requirement of your current situation. So the second thing is case study, which is what, you know, many B-schools do these days. And it is a patent of Harvard, where they try to use case study. Now, they just don't use data. I'm quickly reminded of a small metaphor I wanted to place here. Okay, I'll try. Suddenly it came into my mind. I'm not very sure whether I can do that right now, but let me give it a try. So I'm going to give it in form of a data, and then I will convert that to a story. So when it comes to data, it is like this. Two legs was sitting on four legs, eating one leg. Then came a four leg, stole the one leg. The two leg got off the three leg and got back his one leg. I'll repeat it once again. Okay. A two leg was sitting on three leg, eating a leg. Then came four legs and stole the one leg. So two legs got off the three legs and got his one leg back. So do you think anybody can relate this? Okay, Neetaji says got it. Okay, can anyone relate what it is? Now this is a case study. Now people talk about data, figures and all that, but how are we going to relate it to a story? Okay, if I have to put a story across, I'll say that there was a two-legged man who was sitting on a three-legged chair trying to eat his one-legged chicken. Okay, and then a four-legged dog comes and steals the chicken leg, one leg, from that guy. So that one guy, that two-legged guy, gets down from the three-legged chair and gets back his chicken leg. So this is a very interesting case study when I was studying how you can convert case studies into story. So this was something which I found it very interesting. I'm not sure if everybody have got the point, but the idea is you cannot just share data. At times you have to correlate with the person, saying that if this is a person, if Jyotinath is teaching digital marketing, so these are the things he needs to learn. Okay, if it has to go beyond the data, you definitely need to connect with stories. So this is where a case study will come into the picture. The third one is this is just about teaching something.
The third one is, can you get back the single leg and eat it again?
Can you come again?
Did the two legs took back the single leg and ate it?
Yeah, he took back the single leg and ate it. Yes, sir.
It was a happy ending.
This must be the cause for the current crisis.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you.
Thank you. So the third one is to motivate. If you have to really motivate people, you need to, take people like Ambanis or Adanis or whoever you want and share their life history, or you may have to share some of the life history, tell how you motivated, how you got motivated, and how you are motivating others. So motivation requires a little more power in terms of how to motivate and how to make them do it. So this is something which we need to dig deeper and try to understand and share a much more motivating story on how a person got out of a regular situation, he moved into a very tough situation, he made it out of it, and then how he is able to be successful. So you have to give some tips, techniques and stuff like that. And the fourth one is a simple emotional connect. Now, sometimes it may be true, sometimes it may be, you know, imaginary, but whatever it is, we have to put ourselves in that situation. This is to build trust within the learners. Okay, I will repeat the types of storytelling quickly. These are exclusively used by trainers. The first and foremost thing is a memorable incident you share from others' stories, you share from anybody else, which is not directly associated with you, but where you are able to make a relevance. So I think someone has a doubt, kindly hold on, I will take your doubt. The second one is a case study where you try to give some data, take the data, convert it to a person, and then say, if, have you seen our class textbooks off late? It used to be like, if Ram had 6 chocolates, and out of the 6 chocolates, he has given 3 chocolates to Lakshman. He has only 2 chocolates left. So this is something which is really important in today's virtual training, because definitely it needs to have that kind of case study approach when we are going in the online space. The third one is you need to use really powerful motivational stories on how he did it and what you should do in terms of motivating people. The fourth one, of course, is the emotional connect, where we need to put ourselves in and share our personal story to connect, build a connect or trust with our participants. I'm sure we already know about these things, but this is a quick recap and more emphasis on how you need to inculcate these things into our virtual training. Okay, yeah.
Absolutely. So that was really interesting. And what really interested me was your example that you gave about that case study.
Thank you,
that actually brings me to my next question, because we're talking.
Before that, can we quickly, if anybody has doubts, can you quickly, you can just type.
Yes, please.
4ST. 4ST, if you have got all the 4 points. If you think you have not got it, if it is simple, I will answer it now. If it is a little, you know, if I have to go back and explain the entire thing, I will take it after the meeting is over.
Yep.
Okay. So most of them have got it. So people who have not got it are free to call me, and I can explain these things a little later on in detail also. So now let's go into the next question. I will hand it over to Vaidhiji.
Yes, absolutely. So when we talked about your case study, whenever we think about these 4 types of storytelling, one of the key things that comes to our mind is the use of images and text. So I just wanted to ask you if you have any strategies for balancing text and images on screen for virtual trainings.
See, I think the simple technique which we use in advertising is we use an emotional image and we give the text rational. Okay. So the emotional image is you will have a huge flat or you will have a wonderful villa, something in front of you in the image. And the rational text will be something like affordable. Okay, now emotionally it appeals to you that image is going to be having an emotional connect, whereas the text is going to be more rational. Now, if I have to put it, I'm hoping all of you would have seen some ads or something like that. So our slides also should be of the same thing. You need to have a very powerful emotional image and have the text very rational. Okay, now, why is that required? Now, assuming I'm sharing a small example, there is a small conversation between a husband and wife going on. Husband and wife go in for, in a yacht. Okay, yacht is a small boat which you can own. And the wife says, what if we try to pull in all our money, whatever we have, and buy a yacht? And the husband just puts his hand into his pocket and opens the wallet and says, all I have is credit cards and debit cards. The wife says, it's okay, you can try to, you know, somehow pull in money. Just think of the wonderful days, the time we would have in the yacht. Okay. The husband says, tries to argue. And then finally, who wins? Who wins? So, can you just type it in the chat box? Who would win?
The wife, obviously.
Yes, of course. It's a universal truth.
Yes.
Men maybe think rational. I'm not very sure. Again, there may be disputes on that. But men maybe think rational. Women are more emotional. But at times, not at times, mostly, we take decisions based on our emotional approach. Buying never happens rational. It's mostly emotional. Okay, if you look at any impulsive buying, it is mostly emotional. Very hardly you buy things rationally. That would be your regular ration, nothing else. Ration, whatever we call. Ration is only used for ration, nothing else. Otherwise, everything is more to do with emotional purchase. Okay, so thank you so much. Thanks for why it is politically correct. Yes, thank you so much. Thanks a lot. So thanks for the nice messages in the chat box. Now, can we go on to the next step? Is it clear? So the image should be more emotional. The text should be more rational. That is how your slides should also be, because that is where we will be able to build a connection with our learners.
Absolutely.
So does that answer your question, Vaidhiji, or any?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. That really answers my question. Thanks a lot for that. And I think the next question is going to be really popular among trainers. See, basically, a lot of trainers, one of the key challenges that comes when it comes for trainers is to design those really beautiful looking slides that we see everywhere. And some slides, are, I mean, for example, we see Apple's presentation and all of those things. The slides are looking so beautiful and so slick. So, and when it comes to trainers, yes, we have trainers who design some great slides, but trainers usually focus more on the content and they have challenges in terms of the time that they have. And some trainers also have challenges when it comes to their technical expertise. So can you give us some tips for trainers who are lacking in technical expertise and for creating such beautiful slides?
Okay, so these are some of the slides. Before that, okay, I wanted to also share some of the things you need to take care before you share a story. I'm so sorry.
Sure.
I think I will take one step back and go back to say these are some of the 8 questions which we need to answer before sharing a story. So, is there a story structure or how can you frame your story? Now, these are some of the 8 popular questions which we need to answer so that, you know, normally what happens is, as adult learners, now if you look at you know, our learning in childhood, before teenage, we were adult dependent learners. So basically your mom or our mom or dad says, read this subject today. So you read science, we are bound to read it. So we were adult dependent when it came to you know, learning something. When it came to teenagers, then we thought, okay, so this is something true. If our teacher, if our lecturer is telling, maybe it's true, we will blindly follow it. Now, after our education, when it comes to adult learning, we don't accept these things. We are very, very skeptic. So when it comes to, you know, accepting things, we always, our mind says, why should it be this way? Why not this way? So we become very skeptic. So when you are sharing a story in a classroom, maybe somebody will interrupt and say, no, just tell me something. Where did this happen? How did this happen? Now, that cannot happen in a virtual session. So we need to ensure that we are trying to give a story outline very clearly. So when I say PPT on the online or virtual space, it is mostly story. So I just wanted to share these quick tips. The first one is, why should I listen to the story? Which is very important. Now, somewhere you need to say that, okay, now assuming I'm sharing a small example. I have a colleague or I know a friend of mine who got thrown out of Infosys. Okay, not Infosys, any other company, let's say. Okay, IBM. IBM is the latest trend now, not Infosys. So there are many news articles which are coming out that IBM has thrown a lot of their employees out. Now, if I'm going to say that my friend got thrown out of IBM, there's no emotional connect. Now, I have to tell how this guy was connected to me. I have to tell he was my college mate. I used to be weak in Max. Then he used to really help me out in a lot of stuff. And then we got placed together in an organization, or we were, he got placed. He was so kind that he was helping a lot of people in his workspace. He used to take others' work. If somebody went on leave also, he would take up his work. He would answer a lot of questions which, his boss, his team members, his peers would fear asking his superiors. Okay, normally these are some things which we have to share. So when I tell all these things and then say he lost his job. Now, when I say he lost his job, what is the emotion we are eliciting? Versus when I create a story, tell how he was associated, what was he in the past, what is he right now, how he used to be with his team members, what was his attitude, what was his the nature of that person. Now you feel some sympathy and empathy towards the person that, oh my God, in spite of he being such a wonderful person, why was he thrown out of IBM? Are we getting the point? So if we have to look at creating a story, we need, emotionally connected, yes. So this is where you need to build in. So why should I listen to this story? So you need to give a background of why a person should listen to the story, because just saying he lost his job is not going to really help. So you have to tell how he was associated with you, when and where. It was during this time when he was like this, when we were in Bangalore and we got connected. So that is how you have to give when and where. We also need to give certain characters of the main or the protagonist, and we have to say what did they want. I mean, so basically these are kind of things you need to, you can take a quick screenshot of this or you can take a picture. So what is the problem or what is the opportunity they ran into, and what did they do about it? So what was the end result? And when you come to a conclusion of the story, the most important thing is, I think you need to ask the participants to tell, if you were in this situation, what would you do? So that is what is all about in the online space. So you need to ensure, since we don't have much of time, you need to ensure that your participants share their point of view.
So meanwhile, can I ask you one quick question?
Yeah, Mainu, who's this place? I'm not able to see you.
Neha Gupta from Delhi.
Yeah, Neha ji, boliye madam.
Sir, you use this purple, violet and blue mixing in each and every slide. So
yeah.
Could you just quickly tell me which feature in the PPT, the recent PPT you have applied, which tool?
See, you can actually go to flaticon.com, F-L-A-T, flaticon.com, and you have all these icons which are similar. Okay, you can actually bring...
Can you spell it again, sir? F-L-A-T, flat.
Yeah, I'm going to put it now in the box also, I mean in the PPT also.
Yeah.
Flaticons.com.
Share the screen.
So it's even for the background which you had made by mixing two colors. So this website
that
is
in PPT. That is in PPT.
So which tool you have used, sir? Which feature?
The same gradient background.
Gradient background. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
okay.
The background effect, whatever this is, the, what you are asking, right? This and indigo background.
Yes.
I've used the gradient background. If you click on this, you'll be able to see that I've used a color shading from here to here, which is available in the format.
Okay, gradient background, right?
Yeah, gradient background. Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I think I've pretty much covered the story structure. So these are some of the things you need to look at. The first six is about the trainer. He needs to ensure that he shares the story on why people should listen to the story, when and where did it take place, who is the main character and what did they want or he want, what was the problem, opportunity. Why did they do? What did they do about it? How did it turn out at the end? So these are some of the points. Now here I've used a lot of text, of course, because I had no other alternative. I had to put it in form of a text. And this was a last minute development which came up. So I quickly wrapped it up by putting a text. But here also, if you look at it, I'm sure most of you are able to read the content. So content should be readable. So the font, styling and all that was uniform. Okay, Vaidhiji, I will go ahead. Can I request you to share your next question? Before that,
okay.
Yeah, before that, any doubt in story structure? You can say yes, yes, if you are clear about the story structure. You can say yes, yes, if you are clear about the story structure. Somebody has a doubt, you can unmute yourself and ask your doubt. If it is simple and if it can be immediately explained, I will do it right now. Otherwise, I will take it on a one-to-one call later.
Okay. Okay, so I guess we can continue. So just to repeat my earlier question, I was asking about some tips from you for trainers who lack the technical expertise to create those beautiful slides. Okay. That we see in presentations.
Yes. So these are some tools. These are online tools. Most of them are free. I'm sure some of you already know it. The first and foremost thing is Canva. So of course, you know, PPT has got a lot more features, but Canva is a lot more creative. So there is nothing that you can do to straight away, magic can't happen. Definitely we need to master one tool, but Canva is a very simple tool where you can do a lot of gradient background and you can try to, you know, bring in some shapes, some style. You can use arrow pointers, you can use animation, you can create video using that. The next one is Visme, visme.com, visme.com, which is also a great site where you can create business presentations. For example, it is very good for infographic kind of a stuff. So you can also look at Visme. You can just take a picture of this. So these are all simpler tools. I request all of you to try these tools and see which works really well for you. Okay, so you can download that as a JPG file so that you take the entire screen and just replace it with that image. So these are tools which you can use. Of course, you know, PowerPoint has ready-made templates which you can use, but they may not really be conveying your core message. So in case you want to try your hands on different online tools, you can try Canva, which many of you already know. Visme is a tool which many of you may not really know. That is a great tool for creating PowerPoint presentations. For example, you know, you want to show infographic of a person climbing up the stair, or you want to use some icons where, you know, a guy is sitting in a rocket and going up. So these kind of great icons, 3D icons, are available in Visme. You can actually download that to a JPG file and bring it and put it in your PowerPoint slide. You also have Haiku Deck. Now, you may want to use some animations here and there. This is a great place where you can create animations, scratch.mit.edu. This is Massachusetts Institute of Technology. I don't know how to pronounce it. Massachusetts. My pronunciation is bad. Yeah. Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT.edu. So where you can create some animation gamification for your training, which means that you can create small animation, you can create some voices and stuff like that. And this can also be done in Hindi. That's the advantage. Now you also have Powtoon, where you can create your animation slides in form of an animation. Now, this is the same thing, you can create video slides, which means that if you want your video to run for 1 minute or something without any interference of yours, you can create that using Powtoon. This is also an animation tool and it is a video presentation tool. Now you also have VideoScribe, where you can you know, it's like TikTok, where you can create your videos, edit it, and you can try to do a lot. Today, many of the trainers are using TikTok to create videos for their trainings. So that's becoming a great platform for training as well. I used it, right? TikTok is again a great platform. You have Prezi. You also have Picture Effect. So these are some of the tools which we can use in the online space. Just try your hands on these things other than PowerPoint. Now, there is no silver bullet approach. Now, coming to your question, Vaidiji, there is no fixed, you know, ready-made PPT, which is magic, where it understands your thought and it creates a PPT for you. Definitely, okay. We need to try our hands on these things. You may definitely find Visme very comfortable to get very nice infographic, for example, for case studies, for data, you'll find Visme very important. And for Canva, of course, you can create great slides where you can try to create focal point. You can try to create, put pictures in various grids and frames.
Yep.
It's going to be very helpful.
Absolutely. So I have actually used Canva, VideoScribe, and Powtoon myself. So these are fantastic tools. And I see some new tools over here that I have not heard of. So I'm going to be trying some of those.
I'm sure you'll fall in love with it.
Thank you. Thank you. Let me go ahead and try that. And there is one question on chat asking whether these tools are free. So I don't think all of these tools are free.
Yeah.
They have both free and paid versions. So you can evaluate these tools. And if you want more features or if you want stuff without the watermark and things like that, you can go in for the paid version.
Jyoti, sir, one more question, just a quick one.
Yeah.
What did you tell about the substitute for TikTok? Which one of it?
VideoScribe.
VideoScribe, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
So some of these tools can be used free, provided you use it right. There are means and ways where you can try to use it free. But some of the video animation, if you look at scratch.mit.edu, it's a free animation tool, which is actually great. And I'm sure if you have kids who are around 10 to 15 years old, I think this will be a great tool for them to for you to keep them occupied throughout the day. As parents, we can definitely have some relaxed time making them do some animations for us. And they would also love doing it themselves. Yeah.
That's actually a good idea for this lockdown period. Thanks a lot.
I'm also going through the same kind of pain, so I just wanted to share it.
Thanks a lot for that. So the next question I have is, it's a very simple question. So for a 60-minute presentation, so how many slides would you recommend we create for a virtual learning training?
There is no hard and fast rule. There is something called as 5-5-5 rule in corporate, where it is 5 slides, 5 bullet points, 5 words in a bullet point. There is something like that. Then you have 10-20-30 rule, where you have 10 slides, 20 concepts, and 30 points you want to discuss or something like that. But I think in virtual training that really doesn't it doesn't come into the picture at all. See, for example, for the last 1 hour, 1.5 hours, I've used about 9 slides.
Right.
So that depends. In case you want to talk for using 1 or 2 slides, you can, or if you want to create 20, 30 slides or 100 slides also, it is fine. But it depends on the depth you want to cover. For example, if I have to answer that question, which of these 3 things do you want to actually do? Is it just a VPD presentation? Or is it performance support? Or is it skill-based? If it is skill-based, I cannot do everything in PowerPoint. I have to go out of the PowerPoint, teach something, and again come back to PowerPoint. So definitely, based on the kind of training, maybe we can decide on the number of slides there. There is no hard and fast rule according to me. My personal view.
Okay, that's great. So I'm having another question here about Shutterstock. So I can answer that. So Shutterstock, you can definitely buy images, but I would like to suggest another place where I usually go to. It's called Unsplash. So this is again a free website. It doesn't require any licensing or any attribution, and they have some great quality images that you can download. So this is a place that I go to very frequently. I've put the name on the chat window. So you can definitely.
Yeah, actually, I expected this question. I have it ready in the next slide.
Okay.
So what are the sources for getting images? Because the images would be the most interesting thing. So, can I quote to the next slide, which talks about what are the sources available?
Absolutely, please.
Okay. So these are the top websites which are there. One, I'm sure most of you already know, freepik.com. We also have one more for icons, which is flaticon.com. Let me add that. So flaticon.com, you also have Pixabay, you have Pixels, where you can get a lot of videos also. You can look at Unsplash, stocksnap.io, mmtstock. So apart from that, you can also go to Google. When you search for images, you can look for images which are free for reuse.
Yeah.
So those are images which you can definitely look at, because some of the images we may find it relevant in Google also. So these are all these places where you can get royalty-free images, which means that you can straight away start using it.
Okay.
Beyond that, if you want to look for in the Google searches, I have also given you tips on how you can search using Google Images. That is images.google.com. If you go and upload an image, you will get all the relevant images which are similar to that.
Yes.
So these are techniques where we can find a lot more relevant images. So I think, I will hand it over to Vaidhiji again. So
yes.
Any other doubts, please type it in the chat box. We are nearing the end.
Yes. So yes, sir. I have just one last question for you for the day. We would like to know if you have any tips for us for publicizing virtual programs. I'm sure this is a question that is going on in the minds of a lot of trainers who are in this call right now.
Yeah.
Because this virtual world is so new to us. So if you can give us some tips on how to publicize virtual trainings, it'll be of help for us.
Perfect. So see, if you're targeting corporates organic, in an organic way, if you don't want to spend money, and if you're targeting corporates, blogs is the best way, and you need to use the right keywords, but that's a different session altogether. You can go to Google Keyword Planner and try to find out keywords which are related to your blogs. Start writing that. So if somebody is searching for something, your blog will start coming up on the top. But if you're planning to do some public workshops, Facebook and Instagram paid advertisements is the only place where you can convert your, if you're doing public workshops, that is the most important thing. Now, if you look at IATD also, we are undergoing a lot of transition going from print to digital space now. So it is now, earlier it used to be 20-80 ratio. Now it is almost 60-40 ratio where the digital spends is going up, because that is a very great medium to ensure that you get a lot of participants to join your course. Now, right. I think this is something, if you want to create, see, these are for creating your own ecosystems, which means that you are trying to get your candidates, you are trying to promote the training programs, and you are trying to sell your training programs. Now, for this, I think Facebook and Instagram advertising will be the best option. Now, if you are creating your own videos and you want to promote it, I think Teachable is one platform. I'll just put it in the chat box. Teachable, they charge around $39 a month. You also have Kajabi, K-A-J-A-B-I. Kajabi.com, which is slightly cheaper. And anyways, you can also, to make it more simpler, you can just say related:teachable.com, and you will get at least some 20 odd platforms which are similar to Teachable. You can always try Thinkific. Yes.
Thinkific is a good resource.
Yes. So these are platforms where you can depend on their ecosystems. They are going to promote it for you, and you can get into it. Even for online coaching, I think the most important thing is to emotionally connect with the prospective learners initially on certain strong stories, how they will be able to perform after undergoing this course. I think these are some of the most important things we need to share. So I'm hoping this was, throwing a little light on how we have to differentiate between the regular training versus the digital training or the virtual training. So thank you so much. Thanks a lot, Neeta ji, Mahesh ji, and a lot more people. I'm so sorry. Chat box, Sudhanya ji.
So we would like to really thank you for joining into today's session. We really hope this was useful for you, and like I had put in the chat box, I will be uploading a copy of this video on my channel, the Empathic Designer Podcast. And as part of this channel, we do a lot of videos on learning and development. So I usually post videos, at least one video a week. And we are planning to do a lot more interview series like this with a lot of experts from the industry that we will be posting on the channel as well. So you can go there and subscribe to my channel for getting those regular updates. So I've just posted that link on the chat box. So you can go ahead and do that. So once again, Jyotinath sir, thanks a lot.
I have a strong message.
Yes.
I request all of you to just take a few minutes and go to Vaidhi's channel. He's really been doing a great job. And I find his videos very, very useful for us as trainers. I think being an L&D professional, even before coming to IITD, IITD has, you know, sharpened the axe. Probably the axe was already sharp, but maybe it was just a sharpening of axe. So if you look at his videos, I'm sure it is very, very informative. You all can go and watch those videos. I'm sure it'll be very useful for all of us. Yeah. Over to you, Vaidhi.
Thank you, sir. I would like to thank all the participants and thank you, Jyotinath sir, for joining in and taking so much time from your schedule to talk to us and give us such a wealth of information this evening. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks to everyone and wish you all a wonderful evening.